It's Dave Politis, Can-Am Missing Project, a copyrighted edition for our video channel. Thanks for being here. I'm honored that you'd stop by. We're broadcasting from northern Montana, about 60 miles, 70 miles from the Canadian border. And right now, it's one of the nicest days outside all year. 45 to 50, no wind, beautiful blue skies. Everybody was outside today. And I can understand why. Kind of when the spring hits up here, everyone gets out of the home and gets outdoors. Today, we kind of had a spring cleaning day, made a couple dump loads of garbage to the dump, and Huck was outside sunning herself, kind of keeping her eye on things. It was a good day, very enjoyable. And update, missing 411, the UFO connection is still rolling hard. It's amazing to me how many people still haven't seen it, but a ton, way more have not seen it than seen it. But a lot of people have, and a lot of people are still talking about it. So thank you for the people out there that that are still churning the waters and talking about it and bringing it up on forums and things. And then, you know, we also have two other movies, Missing 411 and Missing 411 The Hunted, out there. You can watch most of them on Amazon. So please continue to watch those. I don't talk about my books very often, but I think I will today. I've written 11 books on missing people. I'll start with the title Missing 411. And do not buy them on Amazon. You will get ripped off. You'll get charged three or four times what I charge on our website. Our website is NA, like North America, nabigfootsearch.com. And if you go there, just go to the online store and you'll find all of our books, DVDs, posters, etc. Yeah, the books are the backbone of what keeps us alive. So all that is appreciated. And if you can't afford it, then just ask your local library to carry it. And we get library requests all the time, ship them out all the time. So yeah, we do accommodate that. Anything else I needed to cover here? Our world is very strange and people are very stressed right now. And everyone needs to take a deep breath. And remember, we're all the same species. And at a great time of need, pushing race, ethnics, politics aside, we'd all help each other. So remember that when you see somebody in distress on the side of the road or coming out of a store, be nice to them. And there's some really fascinating letters today. Here we go. Dave, I just put your missing person content on. It's not easy for anyone to make that decision. When did I say that I tried to open my safe and it had dead batteries? The only keys were a 10-minute drive to my mom's house. You know, I'm in Ontario. The fact that you're one of the only people that realize mental illness is rampant and very misunderstood is sad. Like I said, the problem was and still is so misunderstood. Mental illness is entirely misunderstood. Within the last year, I've been educated greatly on marijuana. And I was around when the THC value of a joint was so small, it could barely get you loaded. And now THC content is so high that get you loaded quick. There's a lot of studies being done now on marijuana and THC. Now, what's happened in just the last 20 years is that the number of people being diagnosed as bipolar has skyrocketed, as has the THC content with marijuana. Marijuana is not what it was years ago. You got to be careful with it, very careful. And back when I was younger, when I was a cop, I didn't have any problem with people smoking it. Again, it was very low quality THC, low quality weed. Most people couldn't afford the good stuff. I think if I was going to make some recommendations to people now, I'd say just stay away from it. Stay away from it. Especially if you're under 30. Brain's developing. You don't need it. You don't need it. Don't self-diagnose and then self-medicate yourself. The disgusting fact that nobody is trying as hard as you to make this matter understood hurts a shitload. I have 4 or 5 friends with teenage daughters who have had eating disorders. Few of their daughters have already tried, blankety blank, he's having to keep his daughter at the hospital on suicide watch. Sorry if I'm a broken record, but it's hard to understand how I felt when I said, screw it. It wasn't an easy decision, but yes, I did smile for the first time, almost 2 years. I wish I could tell you this every time you get upset. If it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here. Mental issues are so misunderstood. I'm getting through some hard parts now, and it's because of you. I wish I could thank you more. No joke, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here. Hiding in my room and self-medicating was all I could do at that point. Don't know how I came across you and your content, but I did, and it saved my life. Sorry to be a broken record. Hope all is well. And my mom and all the people that care about me say thank you. God bless you and the people that care about you. It's humbling. Humbling. You know, if I can help one person, I've done a great thing. So I'm glad I helped this person. Hey, Dave. I want to write and thank you for all your hard work. I especially appreciate all you do to promote mental health awareness. My brother turned me onto your YouTube channel last summer after he had watched a video about missing people in the Selway wilderness. And he thought it might be a good idea for me to watch the video since I have gone elk hunting in that area with my in-laws. And during those hunts, I did a couple of solo hunts. Since watching your videos, I now hear your voice saying, bad idea. My uncle has always sent me out with a GPS radio so we could keep in contact with each other, which is a good thing. Around the time my brother referred your videos to me, my wife of 11 years moved out. I was in utter disbelief and shock because I had not seen as a warning signs. She just told me one day that I wasn't man enough for her. That I was too weak and needy and had to be done trying to save our marriage for the past 2 years. Now she was done. I was devastated. And my mental health took a rapid decline and I seriously considered ending my life because I had failed her. Then all my successes meant nothing and I didn't deserve to live. We have 2 children, twins, a boy and a girl, and both are autistic. The thought of leaving those 2 sweet children without a daddy was strong enough pain that I felt and it gave me the drive to push through and get the counseling that I needed. I could be there for my babies. I've since come to realize that I was married to a female narcissist and there was nothing I could do to save the marriage. Your videos have helped me so much during this journey and have given me something other than stupid love songs to listen to. I've also been doing an emotional self-reliance class through the local LDS ward and I would highly recommend it to anyone rather than you're a part of the LDS faith or not. Also plan on doing a NAMI class afterwards per your recommendation and the recommendation of a family friend who was a counselor. He said that NAMI is great for parents with special needs. Yes, it is. I know this has been a long one already, but I have one experience I'd like to share. Okay, before you share that, I want to cover something that you said earlier. This one part. She told me one day that I wasn't man enough for her. Tell you one thing, Angie could have left me 100 times in the last 2 years if she had the attitude that that woman did. Yeah, there were many times that I probably wasn't manly enough in the eyes of a few. If you think about losing somebody. Nobody really knows how you feel. They know how they feel. But there's that old saying, nobody knows how I feel. Nobody knows how I feel. And I've never resented that nobody knew. But I really don't think many knew. And just like what this person said about his wife saying he wasn't man enough. It's a low blow. Low blow. They need to even say it. If you dislike somebody so much, just leave. Don't crush them. That's right. Angie stood by me when there was nobody else. Because everyone else was going for cover. And she had her feelings and her concerns for Ben, too. I'm sorry you didn't have somebody like that here. I know this has been a long one already, but I have one experience I'd like to share. It was, I believe, in September, about 4 years ago, when I was driving on my way home from work between 5 and 6, when I noticed a shiny object in the sky. There's a small airport in Driggs, Idaho, and at first I thought it was a plane circling to prepare for landing. The craft suddenly sped up, and I prepared to make a quick U-turn in a way that I've never seen anything other aircraft do, and then there was a brilliant flash of light and it disappeared. It amazed me so much that I pulled over and watched the sky for a few minutes trying to see if it would reappear, but it never did. I've always been a little skeptical of UFOs, but I served a mission in my church in Nova Scotia and met a lot of people who claimed to have been abducted. These people were always strung out on some kind of drugs. And then one day I was talking to a friend about these witnesses and they said, were they on the drugs to cope with the addiction or abduction? I'm no longer a skeptic. I definitely know that there are other entities out there. We have to learn a lot about our world and universe around us. So sorry for the loss of Ben. I can only imagine the pain you must feel. I'm grateful that you share your trials so openly. I found that we can draw strength from one another by sharing our trials. I found a lot of strength from all you share. Thank you. Hey Dave, my name is blah blah blah. I'm a qualified hypnotherapist from Australia. Back in the day, I ran a special UFO exploration team of three, myself and another hypnotherapist and a physicist who migrated to Australia from New York. I feel we were way ahead of our time. Our work did not go down well with Australian UFO research groups that day. I think simply because we worked with the UFO and abductees in a grounded, caring, methodical way. The only other researcher here in Australia, to my mind, is Bill Chalker, a respected UFO researcher and author who wrote a book on Hair of the Alien, PCR DNA evidence. Bill's a good, respected man. Also Robert Frola, who owned and ran Australian Ufologist magazine, also a good friend. Really enjoy your YouTube channel. You present a very grounded, methodical way about your research, a rarity in today's world. And let's face it, Bigfoot missing 411 is way harder in my mind than UFO research. I take my hat off to you. Anyways, I wrote articles for Australian Ufologist magazine, which now no longer exists, 97 to 2002 and out of print. Anyways, I came across some articles that I'd written long ago, not all of them, as some lost to time and moving house, and instead of them destined just for my bookcase, thought you might like them for your own personal files, Australian UFO Encounters Archived. And although UFO groups may have improved and become more open over time, I learned the hard way to never work with UFO groups. I have updated the files and added thoughts in hindsight, etc. Anyways, I enjoy your work, dedication, and your dissemination of information. Here's a snippet of an article I wrote on a possible UFO abduction masking event written around 2001. The husband and wife were driving home late at night in a highly populated area when the husband had the urge to take a shortcut home. Normally, the trip would take 30 minutes. This trip, the supposed shortcut, took 1.5 hours. During the hypnosis session, the man only says he saw bits and pieces of alien experience. His wife terrifyingly remembered more as we progressed into the session with her husband. He remembered going down the road and then the road looking strange. He could not easily recognize common landmarks. He knew something had happened but could not recall what. On further deepening, he recalled that the car was frozen. He was alone, and there was a light to the left up in the sky. He heard a buzzing or humming sound. He recalled the car being frozen and being alone. As he was remembering this, he said he felt warm and good, and that the light outside the car was making him feel warm and happy. He remembered a corridor and a hangar-like structure full of alien craft. As he tried to focus up upon the experience, he heard in his mind another thought, which he said emanated from, in his words, the right side of my brain. He turned to his right as if following the memory visually. He literally tracked the thought coming in. It said, "Nothing happened. You just drove home. You feel so warm, happy, and good." It's interesting to note that in this recall of the abduction memory, when recalling the event before the hypnotic induction, he would gulp, and you could easily see his fear and terror. He said, "It took me and my wife over a year to go down that road again, and when we did, it was in the daytime." Now he was remembering two simultaneous experiences, driving home feeling good, and the other, the terrifying abduction. He laughed as the double conflict amused him. The thought of nothing happened comforted him, etc. Have you come across this before with your UFO and abduction research? Nope, I haven't. Next one. "Hey Dave, and continue to enjoy your programs. The latest missing 411 UFO connection was very compelling. Thank you again for all your hard work. I wanted to get your input about camping and hiking. Since watching and reading your books, I've invested a lot of time and effort into being more aware. I first went out and bought a Garmin GPS with inReach capabilities that I paid for monthly for. I have several whistles, extra of everything, and when it comes to hiking and camping, clothing, food, knives, cell phones, extra chargers. The one thing I know you have suggested before, which I'll get, is a firearm. Just don't feel comfortable with one. Is there anything that you suggest instead of a gun? Are there any other things that I need to go out and get in the meantime to go into the wilderness?" So I did a segment, and I've done one every spring, and maybe I should do another one. I take my own backpack, and I go through everything that's in it, and I talk about it. And there's a lot of things. But let me see what I wanted to say here, if I can find it. Well, yeah, let me do this. What is that right there? It's an eraser, okay? Some could say that eraser is a tool. And you use erasers after you learn how and what they're for. And the first time you saw an eraser, you shouldn't have been afraid of it, but maybe you were leery of what it might be. Now you're only afraid or cautious about the gun because of your past, what you've been told and what you've observed. But I want everyone to think about a gun is a tool. Has anybody ever used a nail gun? Oh yes, I have. They're kind of fun. So a nail gun. It shoots a nail into a piece of wood from a big handled device. It could kill you, for sure. Gotta be careful with it. But if I put you in a class, the more time you spend in that class with whatever tool you want to learn about, the more proficient you're going to be, the more comfortable you're going to be with it. I could guarantee I could get anybody comfortable with a gun. Almost anybody comfortable with a gun. if they allowed themselves to be in 10 weeks of classes, an hour and a half a day. I mean, 10 weeks of classes, one class a week, 90 minutes each week, and then you go and practice. I could get you there. There's nothing to be afraid with a gun. You just need to respect it. And it can't be replaced in the woods. I'm sorry. There's nothing in your arsenal that if a bear attacks you, it's going to stop after it attacks you. Nothing. Nothing is going to stop that bear except a bullet. So Angie and I both carry big guns when we're in the woods in Montana. I personally don't know anybody that goes into the woods around here that doesn't carry a big gun. And every year there's always at least a couple of people that get attacked and one that gets killed. And lately, just a year ago, it was a U.S. Forest Service worker walking back to her truck on a trail and she was attacked. So, just my personal thoughts about it. I've lived a life around guns. My dad was a policeman when he was younger, then he became a fireman and retired as a fireman. And guns were around our family. We'd go shoot all the time. He didn't hunt, but he believed in it being prepared and having everyone comfortable around the guns. So next letter. A few weeks ago, you requested some UFO experiences. Forgive the length of this email. I understand you're a busy man. For this story to be told, I must start way back. Throughout the early 90s, my best friend, who was also my boss, spent uncountable hours traveling US 40 heading east and west. Our trips, we viewed many craft flying in unconventional ways, straight up, straight down, etc. March 13th, 1997, heading to Phoenix, down from Fountain Hills. Phoenix is like a big bowl, hence the Valley of the Sun. The same individual and myself were traveling west down Shea Boulevard, traveling into Phoenix, with a perfect view of the entire valley. Perfect timing, perfect view. Yeah, the UFO was extremely huge, blocking the entire view of the sixth mountain, South Mountain. I would estimate the UFO at least 2 miles long in length. We could see it was there. Thousands of Phoenicians gathered a video along with a life-changing perspective, hopefully enough to consider changing the force-fed narrative that humans are alone in this vast universe. On June 15, 2015, my friend and I, yeah, same guy, traveling south down the 51 freeway towards downtown. It's about 5:15 rush hour. The 51 freeway starts northeast, etc., called Dreamy Draw. The 51 winds through Dreamy Draw, then open up. Once past Dreamy Draw, it opens up heading straight south. Once through, it's a straight shot south. You can see cars parked on both sides of the road, staring up, some taking pictures. We both looked to see what everyone was looking at, taking pictures of, and bam! As two UFOs, close, big, so close I can make out details. The 51 has five lanes heading north and five heading south. The UFO on the one east is east of us was so big it stretched across five lanes. The UFO that was above us stretched across the five southbound lanes. They looked identical. They stood stationary only 200 feet above the traffic. No sound. No movement. They just hovered. They were at an angle with lower edges almost touching each other, silver in color. The strange thing, Dave, at least 30 cars were pulled over snapping pictures, people pointing. Then we got back into our office. We seemed to be all over the news, YouTube, talk of the town, nothing. I've always believed inside I knew that with that, all the stars, solar systems, galaxies, universe, it's crazy to think we're alone. But then again, most humans don't realize that most of the stars are suns with their very own solar systems. What an amazing day. Now, on your video about deception crafted by the hidden powers that be, Dave, we need unity in the community. With all the news, there's a force-fed narrative by a conglomerate that owns almost every station. Yep, big issue. Dave, like I mentioned, unity in the community, we need a leader that is smart, promised millions would follow. The approach would have to be old school, no sell, no picks. I know it sounds impossible, but nothing's impossible. Everyone is upset. Every red-blooded American change is more than possible. It's destiny. There are millions of meetings just like the meetings you attend. United we stand, divided we fall. I believe most are reluctant to speak out. It's like Americans get punished for speaking out. When the government can break all laws without repercussions, for the people, for by the people, Dave, the politicians for the politicians. I know we move on when we die. I shared my experience with you as always, but I agree that we take back us when we leave. We take our deeds with what we do when we're here. We don't unite, I fear, for future generations. My situation makes it impossible to move forward with a commitment to help change our path. I currently take care of a dying mom. Just feeding both of us has been extremely challenging. Dave, I vote for you. You're a good man who loves your country and her values, and for what it's worth, make our mark, Dave. Sorry, so long. I'm with you 100%. Well, thank you very much for the kind note. No, I'd never run for office. Because I see so much corruption around everybody all the time, both sides. Lying, cheating. It's just horrendous. Back in the day when I was a policeman, you arrested somebody, there was strong prosecution, and everyone got treated fairly. Nowadays, I'm afraid we're all not treated fairly. And that's the issue. That's why I'm scared. Brazilian UFO hearings. Hey folks, I don't know if you're aware of the Brazilian congressional hearing on UFOs that took place last year around a month after the American fiasco of hearings. Beings are mentioned twice in it. One speaker personally saw an orb about 10 meters in diameter and land on a hill. Two human beings between 3 and 5 meters tall got out of it. There's a recording of it, but he doesn't show it. Another report says that during the Caleres incident, which was the terrorization of an entire island population by these cylindrical shaped crafts, says that she saw two beings inside a window and they were black with blonde hair. Colonel Urang Holanda Lima gave an interview in 97 that he reported human beings as well. He was the investigator of the Caleres incident for months, and he captured 16 hours of video, 500 photos of crafts and beings. Whoever these people are and are from, we share their DNA. So they are not alien to us, but we may be all alien to this planet, or they've developed this technology long ago and have remained hidden. All of Asia and the Near East believe in the jinn, which means the hidden ones. I do find it strange that the Western culture explains away all of India's ancient texts as being myths in the public domain, but privately in the likes of Oxford, it was in the sciences. Read the book, The Giants on Record. They have referred to them as the Sumerians and the Aryans, but who knows what they call themselves. The Kenites and the Phoenicians were half-breeds of this culture. I just think they have put so much effort into covering up both topics that they are one of the same. These folks have been hollowing out mountains for tens of thousands of years at this stage. There are over 200 of these bases in Turkey alone. How do you know? The reason that they do so is because they were displaced from their homes in Alaska and Siberia when the pole moved over that direction. It was in the North Atlantic during the Ice Age. Large people developed nearer to the poles because they had to carry more weight to survive, but they utilized the cold climate to keep cool. When they had to migrate down to warmer regions in the Middle East, they had to live underground where the temperatures were consistent. Some presumed that it was a big problem for them when they exerted themselves in warmer climates. They overheated and would get a heart attack. It forced them to be nocturnal as well. I stand to be corrected when someone rolls out an actual alien, but as far as I can see, it's an Earth-originated high society, and the Germans become part of that. Hitler was looking for Aryans, not aliens, and I dare say he found them. They are stoking the fires of World War III so that they can roll out their advanced technology in order to take full control of the Earth. Going on Robert Jacobs' testimony about the UFOs attacking a test nuclear missile with a dummy warhead, a UFO shot laser beams at it and it fell out of the sky. Whoever is driving these vehicles has checkmated all governments' nuclear armaments. Robert Salas's testimony, who was the ninth speaker at the Brazilian hearing, said that glowing red UFOs had shut down 20 missiles in 8 days, I believe. While in Russia, they activated the launch sequence of 10 missiles, which really scared the heck out of the Russians. But we have to also understand that we have probably been traveling to other planets for thousands of years, if we are to believe the ancient Indian texts. Anyway, I appreciate all you do. Thanks for reading this. Have a great week. Thank you. If you watch this, Missing 411, The UFO Connection, at the beginning I do a short narration, and I talk about, what are we? Are we the ant farm for some entity that we don't understand? Are they here looking for certain DNA, certain personality characteristics, certain types of people that may get along where others don't get along? I don't know. It's hard to say if anybody's looking for anyone anyhow. But the movie ends with some pretty straightforward data about missing people. And it makes some associations that other people have made. Now, people have accused me of saying, hey, you sold out, you said this, you said that. I didn't say anything. Hold your taters. I explained to you what people said. I explained to you how data connects to each other on some of these cases. And if that bothers you that I did that, then the solution is move along. The reality of it is that those are data points. Do with them what you want. But that is what science looks for in associations of different things. That is what the FBI looks for when they profile cases. Now, the missing cases today. Two new cases, never heard before. Never. Now, the first state, we don't talk about it too much, Missouri. Missouri has a lot of strangeness. A lot of strangeness. There's a story for you. A friend of mine went back to see his kids. And I forgot exactly where he was in Missouri, but he was on the edge of some pretty rural area. And his son and his wife lived out there, and it was May. And he drove up in his car, and he got out. Before he got out of the car, he kept looking, and he's looking at the roadway and the driveway, and it looks like it's all moving. And it looks a little harder. It was like billions and billions of little bugs on the ground. And he said, Dave, this is spooky. I didn't even want to get out of the car. And he said, I sat there for several seconds, just looking. And then I tried to think how I was going to get from the car to the front door. And he goes, I eventually did. And I wanted to make sure all the bugs were off of me before I went in the house. He says, it was just a very strange place, a place I'll never forget. That was in May. Well, I've been in those kind of places, especially in tropical regions. It's kind of normal during certain hatches. But this story deals with a man named Bill Bounds, B-O-U-N-D-S, who's 79 years old. He went missing November 5th, 1951. He lived in Vulcan County, or in Vulcan, the city, in Iron County, Missouri. He was hunting in an area called Low Hollow, and he was a retired farmer. He was hunting with his son-in-law, Irvin, and some friends. And the day started with Irvin and Bill hunting together. I think Irvin was probably put in charge of taking care of his father-in-law. And they went to several different deer stands, and they'd stay for an hour, wouldn't see anything, get down, move on. And towards the end of the day, Irvin and Bill decided to get into their car, and they were going to drive 6 miles up this dirt road to the end of this hollow and just look around. So Irvin drove out. Bill got out, grabbed his rifle, actually grabbed his shotgun, and he said, hey, I'm going to go out and just walk up here a bit. I'll be right back. Irvin said, okay. Well, then an hour goes by, 2 hours goes by, it gets dark. You got starts yelling, fires off a couple rounds, doesn't hear anything. Goes back and gets the rest of the family, tells them, they come back. The next day, Bill at that night rather, that first night Bill started to disappear, there were 10 inches of snow on the ground. It started to snow about the time he disappeared, and it snowed all night. Well, the next day, Bill's kids, there's six of them, heard of it, and they all started to come around from other parts of the country to help in the search. His son-in-law said that Bill was in outstanding health. He knew the area they were hunting because he had hunted it for 20 years. So the thought process that he had gotten lost didn't fit with anyone. Thought process that he had a heart attack or something didn't come in because he was in such good a shape. Well, the next day, they rounded up 30 locals, state police, local hunters, business people, and they start searching. And they searched for 6 days straight. And that's a big search. They found nothing. They started at the area where Irvin had dropped off the stepfather. And this is kind of the map of it here. Now, this is where he was last seen. And St. Louis is north of here, about 150 miles. This is the Black River that flows through here. And there's a very thick forested area that runs through there. It's thick. Well, they searched for 1 week. That's usually the end of it in 1951, but the family kept searching. Not that they thought that Bill was alive, because they didn't really, but they wanted to find his body. And they searched for 2 weeks. Nothing. Then, on November 18th, almost towards the end of their second search, a mile and a half from where Bill was last seen, there was a man named Charles Cox who lived in a rural area, and he had a hound dog. Well, the night of the 17th, the hound dog disappeared. And Mr. Cox said that wasn't unusual. He'd take off every once in a while. Pretty tough dog. Well, the dog comes back the next day, next morning, and it's covered with blood. Covered. So he knows that there's a missing man out there, so he calls the state police and he calls searchers. They come over and they take a swab of the dog, and the state police sends it to their lab. And then Bill and the other state police try to coax the dog into taking him back up the trail where he came to show him where all this blood came from. Dog wouldn't go up the trail. But 2 days later, they got the blood sample back. It was human. Now, this is a very remote area of Missouri. Where that blood came from bothered everybody, but everyone's number one thought it was Bill. You know, maybe he died, and maybe there was some predation on the part of the dog. Maybe he died, and a bear or some other animal got into him and opened him up, and the dog went in for seconds. Who knows? But on January 1952, the family organized another major search. And they got about 50 people into that same area again. And part of that group went in where Mr. Cox's property was located, and the other part went in where Irvin last saw his father-in-law. And this search went on for another week. It was raining. And then there's nothing for 4 months. Everything's quiet. On May 25th, 1952, about 6 months after Bill disappears, 6-7 months after he disappears, there's a body that's found on the Black River, the river that flew, that goes right by where that cabin was located. Well, they found the body 6 miles from the place where Bill was last seen. There were no injuries to the body, and there was no cause of death given for the body. But the family recognized the clothing and some paperwork on the body as belonging to Bill. Who was him? Now, what's weird about this case? Lots of weird things. First of all, if Bill was in that river, why wasn't he found in all those searches when the river was really low in November and December? Should have been found if he was in the river then. Now, Bill knew this area like you know your backyard. So everybody discounted the thought that he might have disappeared by getting lost. That wasn't an option. He also told his son-in-law that he was just going to go for a short walk and be right back. He didn't walk towards the river, so what happened? Many people said that this was a big mystery about what might have happened. And then the last big question in my mind, what's with the dog? Yeah, what's with the dog? And what do I mean by that? Is there was no predation on Bill's body when it was recovered. So the dog hadn't chewed on him. Didn't even have any big injuries, the coroner stated. So whatever the dog was into another human that was most predominantly dead, but they never found him. Which is a complete conundrum in my mind, that how could that be if you were so far in the woods? Now, I know the thinking I had at the beginning was, well, Mr. Cox must be involved in some way, except he's the one who called the state police to come over to his house and investigate it. So I think if he was involved, he wouldn't be calling the police. Well, the good thing was Bill Bounds' body was found. He was giving a church burial, and the case was closed. Closed maybe in your mind, not in my mind. Too many loose ends, but that's... when it fits a missing 411 scenario, it's going to sit there, and this one did. You've got water, you've got a hunter, you've got weather, and you got a dog. To me, that's a strong foursome right there. Now, this case is another new one. Never talked about it before. And if you've never been to Victoria, British Columbia, you need to go. It's a short ferry ride from Vancouver out to the island. It's a gorgeous place. Gorgeous. If you get it on a sunny day, you are blessed. But it is beautiful. And this story has to do with the disappearance right near the harbor on that island. And it involves a young boy named Peter Wojciechson, 8 years old, disappeared May 26, 1962. Now, his home was at 522 Rupert Street. So this is the harbor, Victoria Harbor. This is the park. This is his home. He and his brother left their home like they had done hundreds of times before, went down into the park. His brother left at noon, went back to the house, and he last saw his older brother down here in the southern area watching an air show. Now, the kids left at 10 a.m. They'd been to Beacon Hill Park hundreds of times. Their dad said they knew every inch of the ground there. Now, Peter had a speech impediment from a brain injury of getting hit by a car going to the park when he was younger. He was fully functional, he was a little slower than some, and he was still in the first grade. Now, his mom told the boys that they were supposed to be back by noon to go to the movies with other children and the family. Now, he'd been late before coming back from the park, and he didn't arrive this time in time. But his brother Andrew came back at noon and just said his brother was still at the south end of the park watching an air show that was going on. Now, the times that he'd been late before, he'd been really late. Months earlier, the circus had been in town in Victoria. And Peter had, now remember, Peter's only 8 years old. He meets up with a 13-year-old kid, and the 13-year-old takes him to the circus and gets him home at 11:30 that night. Okay, let's stop right there. I guarantee that dog don't hunt in my house. An 8-year-old boy? See, Dave has had too many law enforcement experiences at large city parks. They are a haven for bad stuff to happen. Perverts, weirdos, molesters, prostitution. No. My 8-year-old going to that park? The thought of the 8-year-old going to a bathroom at that park alone? That dog ain't hunting at all. But the Wychesons obviously had a different way to parent. Their son had already gotten hit by a car walking alone to and from the park, suffered a hand injury, but they let him go again. So this time, two boys go out to play. He doesn't come back. The younger one, Andrew, comes back in time to go to the show, and the family leaves and goes to the show. They come back 6 hours later after dinner, and Peter's still not home. So they go walking around the park. They can't find him. Then they call the police. They call the police at 10 o'clock at night. Again, I would have been going crazy at 12:30 in the afternoon. But then again, this wouldn't have happened with my kids. Okay, so this happens on May 26th. May 27th, 50 officers from the Victoria RCMP show up at the park. And they start searching it, every inch of it. The wooded area, the southern area near the ocean, everywhere. They're not finding anything. The next day, 200 sailors are reporting for duty, along with 50 more officers. And the officers dragged the ponds in the park. And the sailors were told that Peter took with him a small soccer ball, not a normal size, a small one that his dad gave him. And he took it with him to the park to play with. So they attempted to find the ball, thinking maybe that would lead to Peter. It didn't. May 29th, parents gave an interview and said that Peter didn't know how to swim. But they were absolutely 100% adamant, confirmed, reaffirmed, affirmed that Peter would never, ever go near water. He was deathly afraid of it. On May 30th, younger brother Andrew was interviewed by the police at length. Andrew says that he last saw his brother on the south side near the ocean watching the air show with a lot of other people. And Andrew said he got hungry, he knew he had to get home, so he went home to eat lunch. May 31st, the story had gotten tons of publicity all over Victoria. And people had seen the police swarming everywhere. Well, two sailors with the Royal Canadian Navy had seen what was going on. So they walk up to a group of policemen and they said, hey, that day that Peter Wychesson disappeared, we saw a boy with two individuals. Their words, not mine. In the paper, it said, we saw that boy with two pervert homosexuals. Their words, not mine. And the police thought, possible, I guess. There was no evidence of abduction. There was nothing in the water, nothing anywhere. But the sailors came together and they described what everyone thought might have been Peter, but they weren't sure. So now it's June 1st. It's been 6 days since Peter disappeared, and they didn't find anything. They haven't found anything. They haven't found any witnesses. They haven't seen him walk away with anybody. He wasn't in the water. He wasn't anywhere. So the police put forth some theories. Theory number one is that he was casually abducted from the park and taken away. They stated that they knew for sure he wasn't on the park grounds property. They guaranteed it. Number two, he was molested and killed. They didn't know where the body was, but that's why they weren't getting any sign of him. And then the third option was he was drowned in the ocean. He walked out to that south side, and this is the ocean right here. He walked down to the south side to watch, fell in the water, drowned. None of the theories really fit, though. And they were getting frustrated. And essentially, the case went numb. They had five detectives working on it, but they weren't finding anything. June 14th. This incident happened May 26th. June 14th. A Navy ship named the Estevan was leaving Victoria Harbor, and it was just north of the Johnson Bridge. So, this is the Johnson Bridge right here. The body was just north of there, way upriver. This is the ocean. This is where he was last seen. This is where his house is. This is Peter. So the Navy ship, about 200 yards north of the bridge, sees a body in the water. And they put a couple Navy guys in. They recover the body. And they turn the body over to the coroner. And through dental x-rays, they confirm the body is Peter. The coroner stated that there were no injuries to the body. And the cause of death was drowning. The police came out and said, we don't know exactly what happened. And then the coroner turns around and says, no inquest for the coroner. I read that. That got me mad. That got me mad. Inquests are to answer questions that are still lingering. And those questions can be answered by witness testimony, evidence brought forward by police, the Navy, etc. But this coroner didn't think the case was worthy of having an inquest. We have a dead young boy with a disability. Key point here. Remember, I've told you before that a lot of these cases that I've worked on involve young boys with disabilities and brain injuries. Now, if you think about what the parents said about Peter, deathly afraid of water, wouldn't go near water. Somehow or another, he got in water. And folks, the key point about this, nobody saw anything. Nobody saw anything. The time and date that he disappeared, there was a huge air show going on off the coast of Victoria. Hundreds of people all over that park, and nobody saw anything. I would think that somebody would see someone if they fell in the water. And this goes back to the cases I highlighted 3 days earlier when we talked about cases in Chicago, in Cleveland, where all of these young men were falling into water and dying. And nobody sees anything. They just magically appear. How did they get there? When were they last there? Yeah, all questions that need to be answered. And when you have a young boy under these circumstances, there's no question there should have been an inquest. Now, part of that inquest would have to do with discussing the parents' behavior on this. I'm sorry. 8-year-old boy going with his 5-year-old brother to a park alone. I'm sorry. This may have been okay in 1962, but I'm sorry. I could never have done that while being a parent. Would have never happened. And let me tell you now, if you are a parent and you have young kids, specifically boys, between the ages of, well, I'd say 3 years old and 13, 14, when they start to get bigger, don't ever let them go in a bathroom, a public restroom alone. I don't care where you're at. I don't care if you're at a department store or you're at a public park. Do not. And go into those, family restrooms. Go into one of those. Let them go in there. And why? You say, well, Dave, that's kind of wimpy. No. There is so much crime, so much molestation, so many lewd acts that occur in public restrooms. It's obscene. And the majority of the public doesn't even know about this. There was a time where there's a big shopping center in San Jose called Valley Fair. It still exists, still there. It's really a nice shopping center. I was there about 2 weeks ago. It's really nice. But back when it wasn't as nice, we had a ton of calls into the police department about sexual acts occurring in the men's restroom. Yeah, public men's restroom, where your 8 and 10-year-old boys walk into and see. And at the time, it was predominantly Macy's and the public restroom for the mall. And they actually put a whole series of people in there undercover, made hundreds of arrests until it was eventually shut down. And it got notoriety as being a place you don't go to and do those kind of things. But that's my public advisement for you today with young kids. Don't. And one of the other thing about Peter was he went to the circus with his friend one time and he came back real late. Circus. Do not ever let a young person, and I mean under 17, go to a circus alone. Circus has the same kind of things at it that a lot of bad places have. There's a lot of drugs. There's a lot of people that like young kids that want to work around young kids for that very reason. Don't. Circuses are generally dangerous places for young kids. And, yeah. So anyhow, those are the two missing persons cases for today. Both very sad. Both found, but lots of unanswered questions with both. I appreciate you being here. Please share this on your social media. Be nice to people out there. See someone in distress, go help them. If you feel the need to do a good deed, go do it. Go volunteer yourself at a homeless shelter someday. It'll be one of the most rewarding experiences of your life. I guarantee it. So follow me on Twitter. I post over there 2 or 3 times a day. David Paulides, Paulides, at Can Am Missing. And a lot of UFO stuff, a lot of Bigfoot stuff, a lot of everything. In the meantime, take care of yourself, be safe, love your family, be nice to your fellow community member. Paulides out.